Welcome to this session. In this session, we are going to see what is Fourier sine and cosine transforms. The Fourier sine and cosine transforms are derived from our Fourier cosine and sine integral representation. For example, we will consider Fourier sine integral representation. From this, we will derive the Fourier sine and cosine transform. Then we will discuss some basic properties and proof of that properties, and finally we will practice some sample problems. So from the Fourier cosine integral representation, we know f of x equal to integral 0 to infinity a of omega cos omega x d omega. Then a of omega is a Fourier coefficient. We re-substitute this Fourier coefficient here. Fourier coefficient a of omega is equal to 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of nu cos omega nu d nu, where nu is our dummy variable. So when we put this a of omega is here, it becomes a double integral expression. So integral 0 to infinity, this is my a of omega cos omega x d omega. Then I put some manipulation. This 2 by pi can be written as root of 2 by pi into root of 2 by pi. I keep 1 root of 2 by pi outside and 1 root of 2 by pi inside this expression. Now this integral, root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of nu cos omega nu d mu, is known as the Fourier cosine transform of this function f of x. So root of 2 by pi into integral 0 to infinity, this expression becomes fc bar of omega cos omega x d omega. This c stands for cosine transform. Now we are going to formally define what is Fourier cosine transform. If f of x is absolutely integrable piecewise continuous function, differentiable at every point except at finite point of discontinuities, then the Fourier cosine transform is defined like this. Fc bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity our function f of x into cos omega x dx. And also we define inverse transform, Fourier cosine inverse, as f of x equal to same root of 2 by pi, same integral 0 to infinity, but instead of this f of x, I use this fc bar of omega cos omega x d omega. See the difference? Here our integrand function fc of omega is a function of omega. That is why integration variable omega. But here the function, argument function f of x, is a function in x, so integration with respect to x. You should identify this change in integration variable. So this is Fourier cosine transform of f of x. This is inverse transform. In a similar way, we can define Fourier sine transform and inverse sine transform. The theorem says that f of x satisfies the absolute integrability and continuity, and it possesses all derivative at all points except the discontinuity points. Then it has the Fourier sine transform. Fs bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity our function f of x into sin omega x dx. Okay, so inverse, we can guess inverse is replace this f of x by fs bar of omega, and this dx is replaced by d omega. So its Fourier sine inverse is f of x equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity fs bar of omega sin omega x d omega. In some textbooks, instead of this 2 by pi, they may write just 2 by pi. In that case, the inverse transform doesn't contains this root of 2 by pi. But for symmetry, I will use root of 2 by pi in both cases. This is our standard notation in standard textbooks related to Fourier transform. Now we move on to some simple problems. First problem is to find Fourier cosine transform of this f of x, which takes the value k in 0 to a and 0 for k greater than a. So we use the non-zero value of this function in this range in the definition of Fourier cosine transform and finish the integration. So fc bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of x cos omega x dx. But this cos f of x is k, the constant k within the range 0 to a. So instead of this 0 to infinity, I put the value of f of x k in the range 0 to a. So we can take this k outside and integrate with respect to x. We got k into root of 2 by pi integral of cos is sin omega x divided by derivative of this argument with respect to x, that is omega. When you put the limit, we got sin omega a omega minus sin 0 is 0. So answer is k into sin omega x omega a by omega, k into sin omega a by omega into root of 2 by pi. This is Fourier cosine transform of this function f of x. The next slide we will see the Fourier sine transform. We follow the same method. Instead of cosine transform, I will use sine transform definition. So fs bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of x into sine omega x dx. In our case, f of x equal to k in the range 0 to a. In other area, it is 0. So we evaluate this integral like this. I take k outside. Integral of sine is cosine. Integral of sine is minus cosine. I take this minus outside and also k here. Then when we put the upper limit cos omega a minus lower limit cos 0. Cos 0 is 1. So we got cos omega a minus 1 in the numerator. But there is a negative outside. When we multiply this bracketed expression by this negative, I got root of 2 by pi into k into reversed. This limit will reversed. 1 minus cos omega a by omega. That is our Fourier sine transform. Then we will do Fourier cosine transform of a non-trivial function. It is not constant function. E raised to minus ax, where a greater than 0. First of all, we write the Fourier cosine transform formula, then substitute f of x is equal to e raised to minus ax, then finish the integration. That is the procedure. So fc bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of x cos omega x dx. Instead of f of x, I put e raised to minus ax. Then we use the standard results of this integration. E raised to minus ax divided by minus a square plus omega square. That is a square plus omega square. A big bracket, then minus a into cos omega x as itself plus omega into integral of cos is sine omega x. Limit varies from 0 to infinity. When I put upper limit here, e raised to minus infinity, that goes to 0. 0 into a finite quantity, so 0 minus. When we put lower limit, e raised to 0 is 1. 1 into sine 0 is 0, so these terms goes to 0. So cos 0 is 1, so minus a, minus minus a. So we got root of 2 by pi into a divided by a square plus omega square. That is our Fourier cosine transform. Next, we are going to discuss some properties of Fourier cosine and sine transform. The first property is called the linearity property. Formally, it is defined like this. If f of x and g of x are absolutely integrable on positive x-axis and piecewise continuous on every finite interval, then Fourier cosine transform of af plus g is equal to a into fc bar of f plus fc bar of g. Similarly, scaled Fourier sine transform scaled sum is equal to scaled sum of individual transforms. We will prove this using the linearity property of integration. First of all, we start with Fourier cosine transform. Fc bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of x cos omega x. Instead of f of x, I use af plus g. So root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity a into f of x plus g of x into cos omega x dx. Then I multiply this cos omega x into this bracket. So root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity a into f of x cos omega x plus g of x into cos omega x dx. I split this into two integral, because integral is a linear operator. I take this constant a outside, a into root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of x cos omega x dx plus root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity g of x cos omega x dx. But this is Fourier cosine transform of f, this is Fourier cosine transform of g. So we get a into fc bar of f of x plus fc bar of g of x. Next, we will start with definition of Fourier sine transform. We do the same thing. Instead of this f of x, I write af plus g. Then we multiply this expression by sine omega x, split the integral, we got the same result. Our result is fs bar of af plus g same as a into fs bar of f of x plus fs bar of g of x. Same format. The thing is, we simply apply the linearity property of integration. In next slide, we will see another property, Fourier sine and cosine transform of derivative. In Laplace transform, we have seen that when we take derivative of Laplace transform of derivative, it automatically changes to multiplication by S in transform domain. We get almost similar result, but there are some changes. Formally, it is defined like this. Let f of x be continuous and absolutely integrable function on the x-axis. Let f dash of x be the piecewise continuous on every finite interval, and f of x tends to 0 as x tends to infinity, then fc bar of f dash of x, Fourier cosine transform of derivative, is equal to omega into fs bar of f minus root of 2 by pi f of 0. See the difference. Here I take Fourier cosine transform, it changes to a multiplication by omega of sine transform. Similarly, Fourier sine transform of derivative is equal to minus omega into Fourier cosine transform f. The sine transform changes to cosine transform. We will prove it using integration by parts and use the definition of Fourier cosine transform. By definition of Fourier cosine transform, we have fc bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity our function f of x into cos omega x dx. Here our function is f dash of x, so fc bar of f dash of x equal to same result, but f of x is replaced by f dash of x. See, this is a product, so we have to apply integration by parts, but the first term contains a derivative, so it is better to rearrange these terms, because in integration by parts the result is like this: first into integral of second, the second one is derivative, then integral and derivative differential will cancel, so we get f of x. That is the idea. So we apply integration by parts, first function into integral of the second. Integral of f dash is f, limit varies from 0 to infinity, but note that limit is common to both these terms, because both cos omega x and f of x contains the term x. Then minus integral of derivative of the first, derivative of cos omega x is minus sin omega x into omega. I take that minus omega outside, then integral 0 to infinity sin omega x into integral of second function, that is f of x dx. Now we multiply this expression by root of 2 by pi into this bracket and also substitute the limit. When I put upper limit, is f of infinity tends to 0, so upper limit goes to 0. Then when we put the lower limit, cos 0 is 1, then f of 0, so root of 2 by pi into here root of 2 by pi, this is negative, into cos 0 is 1, then f of 0, 1 into f of 0, then minus into minus positive, then root of 2 by pi into omega, omega into root of 2 by pi, integral 0 to infinity, I reverse the term, so f of x into sin omega x dx. But we know that this expression is Fourier sine transform of f of x, that is our last step. This is first term, so I take it first term, f omega into root of 2 by pi, integral 0 to infinity, f of x sin omega x dx, can be written as fs bar of omega minus this root of 2 by pi f of 0. Now we are going to prove the second one. For that I take the Fourier sine transform definition, fs bar of omega is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of x sin omega x dx. Now our function here f dash of x, so fs bar of f bar f dash of s is equal to root of 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f dash of x sin omega x. As in the previous case, I interchange this term sin omega x into f dash of x, then apply integration by parts, root of 2 by pi into first function sin omega x into integral of the second, integral of f dash, that is f of x in the range 0 to infinity, minus integral of derivative first, integral of sin omega x, derivative of sin omega x is cos omega x into omega, that omega taken outside, then integral 0 to infinity cos omega x, integral of the second term, that is integral of f dash is f of x dx. As in the previous case, we put the limit and multiply by this root of 2 by pi into this bracket. So we got, when we put upper limit sin 0 0, 0 into f of 0, that is 0, then sin infinity is okay, upper limit sin infinity is a finite quantity, into f of infinity tends to 0, so that term 0. In the case of lower limit, sin 0 is 0, so 0 into f of 0, it becomes 0. So upper limit and lower limit goes to 0 minus this omega into root of 2 by pi into integral 0 to infinity, I rearrange this term f of x cos omega x dx. This term is nothing but Fourier cosine transform of this f, so minus omega into Fourier cosine transform of f, so we got the property. Next is a problem, we are going to find the Fourier sine transform of f of x equal to e raised to minus mod x, and hence evaluate this integral. Remember, such type of problems will be done in two stages. In first stage, we will find the Fourier sine transform. In second stage, we will take inverse Fourier sine transform of this f of x. We take Fourier sine transform f of x, then we take inverse Fourier transform of this sine transform. So, first stage, by Fourier sine transform, we write the formula. Here, instead of f of x, we have e raised to minus mod x. Then integrate. Before integrating, this mod x should be removed, because mod x is not integrable. Note that mod x is equal to x if x is positive. Here this is the limit of x, this positive. So e raised to minus mod x changes to e raised to minus x. I repeat, This mod x is actually absolute value of x. If x is positive, absolute value of x is x itself. That is why e raised to minus x sin omega x dx. Now we can integrate this using our previous result. Root of 2 by pi into e raised to minus x divided by minus 1 square plus omega square into minus 1 into sin omega x as itself minus omega into integral of sin, that is minus cos, that minus is here, cos omega x. Then we put upper limit, e raised to minus infinity goes to 0 plus 0 into this term goes to 0 minus, when we put lower limit, e raised to 0 is 0 into sin 0 goes to 0, then cos 0 is 1 minus omega, so minus minus omega. So this expression changes to root of 2 by pi into omega by 1 plus omega square. Now we apply inverse Fourier sine transform to evaluate the integral. By inverse Fourier transform, we have f of x, our original function, equal to root of 2 by pi, integral 0 to infinity, apply the transform function sin omega x d omega. Remember, function is in terms of omega. The Fourier sine transform is a function in terms of omega. Therefore, the integration variable should be omega. Integral 0 to infinity, instead of this fs bar of omega, we will write this root of 2 by pi omega by 1 plus omega square that we have find in the last slide into sin omega x d omega. Now we make some adjustment. Root of 2 by pi into root of 2 by pi is 2 by pi. Integral 0 to infinity omega by 1 plus omega square into sin omega x dx. We need this integral. We have to evaluate this integral. So you change the side. This 2 by pi goes to LHS, so that becomes pi by 2 into f of x, that's all. Integral 0 to infinity, this expression is equal to, this goes to left side, pi by 2 into f of x. But we know f of x equal to e raised to minus mod x. So we got the value of this integral, integral 0 to infinity omega by 1 plus omega square sin omega x d omega is equal to pi by 2 into our given function e raised to minus of mod x. Similar way, we can find the Fourier cosine transform, and the applying inverse cosine transform, we get almost same result. Instead of this omega, in that case, we get 1 by 1 plus omega square sin omega x d omega is equal to pi by 2 into e raised to modulus minus modulus omega. As a homework, I suggest you to do these problems. Find Fourier sine transform f of x equal to e raised to minus ax with a greater than 0. Here we write the sine transform formula. Instead of f of x, put e raised to minus ax. Use the result, we can go to the integral. Find the Fourier cosine transform f of x equal to e raised to minus mod x. Hence evaluate this. We can use the same procedure as in the previous slide. So we get the result, integral 0 to infinity cos omega x by 1 plus omega square d omega is equal to pi by 2 into e raised to minus mod x itself. Pi by 2 into e raised to minus mod x itself. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your patient listening.